Good morning. I want to welcome you to the summer service online from the chapel at Ocean Reef. It's been our privilege week by week throughout the summer to greet you from different places around our home in central Idaho. I certainly hope that you've been enjoying the services, but more importantly, that these have served to give us a sense of connection to one another in the community of the chapel at Ocean Reef. This morning, we're going to be studying one of Jesus' great parables. It's the parable of the Ten Bridesmaids. But before we do, let's pray together as we prepare to worship our great God. Let's pray that prayer that we've been praying week by week. Lord, help us see you more clearly in order that we might love you more dearly and follow you more nearly day by day. Will you join me as we pray together, please? Lord, help us see you more clearly in order that we might love you more dearly and follow you more nearly day by day. Amen. Now let's join together as we worship our great God.
Good morning to our Ocean Reef community. We are Margot and Rich Miller, and we greet you from Hudson, Ohio. We are happy we stay connected to each other through our online summer service. This morning, we are reading the Psalms, Psalm 48, verse 1 through 4, and 13 and 14.
Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord from the heavens. Praise him in the heights above. Praise him, all his angels. Praise him, all his heavenly hosts. Praise him, sun and moon. Praise him, all you shining stars. Praise him, you highest heavens, and you waters above the skies. Praise them, the name of the Lord, for his name alone is exalted. His splendor is above the earth and in the heavens, and he has raised up for his people a horn, the praise of all his faithful servants of Israel, the people close to his heart. Praise the Lord.
This is the word of the Lord. Praise be to God.
Creation, all of the earth, make straight a highway, a path for the Lord. Jesus is coming soon. Call back the sinner, wake up the saint, let every nation shout of your name. Jesus is coming soon. Like a bride waiting for her groom, we'll be a church ready for you. Every heart longing for our King, we sing, even so come, Lord Jesus, come. Even so, come, Lord Jesus, come. There will be justice, all will be new, your name forever, faithful and true. Jesus is coming. God, we wait, you're coming soon. So we wait, God, we wait. You're coming soon. Like a bride waiting for her groom, we'll be a church ready for you. Every heart longing for our King, we sing. Like a bride waiting for her groom, we'll be a church ready for you. Every heart longing for our King, we sing. Even so, come, Lord Jesus. Jesus come, even so come, Lord Jesus come.
Our scripture this morning comes from the 25th chapter of Matthew's Gospel. As I'll say to you in just a few minutes, chapter 24 and 25 of Matthew are two parts of one whole. But we're going to be reading the parable of the 10 bridesmaids. We're going to begin reading at the first verse of Matthew 25. If you have a Bible there with you, I hope you'll open it and follow along as we read God's word together. At that time, Jesus says, the kingdom of heaven will be like 10 virgins who took their lamps and went out to meet the bridegroom. Five of them were foolish and five were wise. The foolish ones took their lamps, but did not take any oil with them. The wise, however, took oil in jars along with their lamps. The bridegroom was a long time in coming, and they all became drowsy and fell asleep. At midnight the cry rang out, "Here's the bridegroom! Come out to meet him!" Then all the virgins woke up and trimmed their lamps. The foolish one said to the wise, "Give us some of your oil. Our lamps are going out." "No," they replied, "there may not be enough for both us and you. Instead, go to those who sell oil and buy some for yourselves." But while they were on their way to buy the oil, the bridegroom arrived. The virgins who were ready went in with him to the wedding banquet, and the door was shut. Later, the others also came. "Sir, sir," they said, "open the door for us." But he replied, "Truly, I tell you, I don't know you." And Jesus concludes the parable this way, saying to us, "Therefore, keep watch, because you do not know the day or the hour." Friends, this is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Preparedness. What does it mean to be prepared? Our family lived in Los Angeles for more than 16 years, and on any given day, the five of us could be separated by miles at different places in the city, and that was before cell phones had ever become commonplace. Our greatest concern as a family was what to do in the event of a major earthquake when those you loved were scattered all over the city. The question we asked each other was, how do you prepare for such an event? Earthquakes, they give you no advanced warnings. It's not like a tornado or a hurricane. In a tornado, you can shelter, or a hurricane, you can evacuate, hopefully. But an earthquake, it happens right now. There's no advanced warning. There's no way to prepare. So you have to be prepared all of the time. Well, today we're going to consider a parable of Jesus. It's a parable in which he is speaking about an event that will take place when no one is expecting it. It's an event for which we need to live our lives being prepared. What's the event that we're referring to? It is the greatest event in all of human history. It's what the Bible calls the end of the age. When secular people hear people of faith talk about the end of the age, they naturally think about the end of the world. And the end of the age will mean the end of the world as we've known it. Some of them may regard you as a religious kook or think all of this talk is nothing more than religious nonsense. But there are some reasons for their suspicion, their skepticism. We're all aware of too many tragic stories of persuasive cult leaders who convince a group of people to sell their possessions, leave everything and everyone, and go to some mountaintop somewhere and wait for the end to come, or worse. Here's the difference. Jesus is no kook. He is God the Son from all eternity. And he's telling us these things not to frighten us, but because he loves us and he wants to prepare us. He's telling us this because he wants more than anything else for each of us to be with him where he is. The 24th and 25th chapters of Matthew's Gospel, they contain some of the most important historical teaching that Jesus ever gave about this promised event, the end of the age. The occasion for the teaching was when Jesus was sitting with his disciples on the Mount of Olives one evening. They were looking across the valley at the stunning beauty of the Jewish temple. Jesus tells this parable because the disciples were reacting to a statement that he made about the future of what was going to happen to the temple and its buildings. He had told them with absolute certainty that not one stone would be left upon another when that day came. His statement had left them stunned, speechless. It was inconceivable. It was impossible for them to think about. But just a short time later, they came to him privately and they asked him two questions. Their first was, "Lord, when's this going to take place?" And the second was, "What's going to be the sign of your coming, the sign of the end of the age?" They wanted to know how to prepare for such a momentous event. Well, in Matthew 24, in response to their questions, Jesus describes a series of unsettling events that will be the prelude to this end of the age. Jesus talks about deception, rumors of wars and global conflict, different natural disasters. He said evil is going to become so widespread that people's love is going to grow cold and dissipate. But then he tells them that all of these things are just the beginning of birth pains. This must mean that God is bringing something new into being through these tumultuous events that Jesus speaks about. When Jesus speaks about birth pains, it should remind any husband who's been through the birth of a child with his wife of the labor pains that she endured. They build like waves of intensity and are most painful just before the joyful moment of birth. Well, in this parable of the 10 bridesmaids, Jesus is using a familiar event in first century Jewish culture to underscore our need to be prepared for the end of the age. As we consider the parable, first, we need to listen carefully. Next, we want to see clearly. And finally, we need to respond appropriately. First, let's listen carefully to what Jesus is saying. One part of careful listening is to try and understand how Jesus' first followers would have understood this in their world, within their time. That means digging into the culture behind the story. Our English translation of the parable begins with, "at that time." Well, in the original text, though, it's just one word. It's a powerful word. It gathers up everything that Jesus has taught about the end of the age in chapter 24, and it ties it all together and prepares us for what he's going to say next in the parable. He says, "When all this takes place, the kingdom of heaven will be like." Well, what will it be like? He said it's going to be like a bridal party at a wedding. 10 unmarried young women, all friends of the bride, who've gathered to celebrate her marriage. Now, here's the surprise. Remember, there's always a surprise in Jesus' parables. Half of them, Jesus says, were foolish, and half were wise. All 10 of them brought their lamps. When you read lamps, I want you to think handheld torches. But the foolish girls didn't bring any extra oil. They were not prepared, and that's what sets them apart from the wise. The wise bridesmaids realized that there might be a long way to delay before the bridegroom arrived, and they were prepared for it. Now, I've officiated at a few weddings where you had 10 bridesmaids and 10 groomsmen plus the bridal couple. But I cannot recall ever seeing bridesmaids lounging around holding torches on their dresses. Torchlights? No. Bouquets? Yes. In the culture of Jesus' day, the bridesmaids would all gather at the bride's home, waiting for the groom and his attendants to arrive and escort them back to the groom's home. The men, they'd gathered on the other side of the village at the home of the groom's father. Then they would joyfully march across the village to the bride's home and take she and her attendants back to the groom's home, where the wedding celebration was begin, and it could go on for days. As Jesus tells it, there was no set time when the groom and his party would arrive at the bride's home. Why was that? Well, in that culture, the groom couldn't leave until his father said to him, "Son, everything is ready." Only then could he go to the bride's home. As Jesus tells the parable, the groom was delayed. In fact, he was very late. It was the middle of the night, and Jesus says that all of the bridesmaids had become drowsy and finally gone to sleep. Then finally around midnight, Jesus says, the announcement goes out. The groom is coming. He's on his way. Everybody, get ready. In Jesus' parable, all of the bridesmaids woke up and they began to trim their lamps. What does that mean? Everyone understood that oil in the torch would need to be replenished. Otherwise, they couldn't see their way through the streets of the village to get back to the groom's home. Being prepared meant knowing that the groom might be delayed, and if so, they knew they would need extra oil to give light for that joyful procession. In the parable, half of them were unprepared, no extra oil. In our world, that would be like having half of your bridesmaids show up at a beautiful formal wedding wearing nothing but cutoffs, tank top, and flip-flops. Wouldn't that be memorable? "Well, lend us some of your oil," the foolish girls asked the wise bridesmaids. Well, the reply of the wise was not selfish or uncaring. It was just fact. If you need more oil, you're going to have to go and buy it, because we don't have enough for all of us. So off they went. But while they were away, Jesus says the groom arrived. He and his party took the bride and those wise attendants to the groom's home, and the festivities began. The 5 foolish bridesmaids, finally with fresh oil, they make their way to the groom's home. And when they do, they begin knocking on the door. "Sir, sir," they plead, "open the door, let us in." The groom replied in Jesus' words, "Go away, I never knew you." Jesus challenges us as he closes this parable with these words. Watch, he says, "be prepared." Why, we ask? Because, Jesus says, "You neither know the day nor the hour when the end of the age will come." I hope that's helped us listen carefully. Now let's look clearly. When you think about the end of the age, What's the first image that comes to your mind? I'll bet the first thing for most of us is not a joyful wedding celebration. A wedding celebration, it brings families and friends together. A wedding, it marks the culmination of a lifetime of investment in your son or your daughter. Seeing your son or daughter find a partner that they want to commit their lives to in the presence of God and friends and family, isn't that the fulfillment of the deepest longing of almost every parent for their child? The marriage ceremony, it's just the starting line. It's the beginning of a lifetime of great hope, of building a great love. Can we see clearly? That's the very image that Jesus chooses to use to describe what it's going to be like when the end of the age comes. Does that surprise you? It shouldn't. Remember what C.S. Lewis says, joy is the serious business of heaven. Well, that joy is what followers of Jesus will experience when we take our place at the end of the age in what John refers to in the book of Revelation as the marriage supper of the Lamb. That day, the end of the age, Jesus says, it will be as joy-filled as a wedding day. It's something to anticipate with great longing. It's something to prepare for. Well, now that we have listened carefully and hopefully seen clearly, let's ask what it means to respond appropriately. We can take two things away from this parable. The first is this: Jesus' promise will be fulfilled. Because we've been waiting for the end of the age to come for two millennia, that doesn't mean that it will not take place, as Jesus said. It just means that the bridegroom is simply delayed. There are many people who, like those waiting bridesmaids, have grown drowsy and fallen asleep while we wait for the promise of God to be fulfilled. The Apostle Peter, writing in his second letter sometime in the mid of the first century, he was confronting the same issue. He wrote, "Scoffers will say, 'Where is this coming he promised? Ever since our ancestors died, everything has gone on just as it has since the beginning of creation.'" I appreciate the way one scholar has given an appropriate response to those scoffers. The uncertainty of when the end of the age will come, he says, that's a non-issue. What counts is the certainty of the fact of our Lord's return. Personally, I never sense that certainty more than when I stand in Jerusalem at the southwest corner of Temple Mount, that great retaining wall below what's called Wilson's Arch. Once, nearly 2,000 years ago, the Jewish temple soared high above in the midst of that 33-acre compound that's on that platform. For those of you who've never been to Jerusalem, you might ask, "Bob, why is that so important?" Well, the reason is the street where you're standing, where you're looking up, that's the place where in 70 AD the Romans sacked Jerusalem. They slaughtered the Jewish inhabitants, and they burned down the temple. The street where you're standing was damaged by the enormous stones that they threw off that retaining wall. Not one stone was left upon another. Those stones, they're still there to this day, piled up for you to see. And those very stones, you see, that Jesus told his disciples 40 years before it took place, they're there as a silent testimony to the truth of what he said. We can put our trust in him and his word. His promises will be fulfilled. He will do it. Here's the second thing. Jesus' promise is deeply personal. We must never forget that there is a reason for our Lord's delay. Peter encourages us again in that same letter. He says, "Don't forget this one thing, dear friends. With the Lord, a day is like a thousand years, and a thousand years like a day. The Lord is not slow in keeping his promise, as some understand slowness. Instead, he's patient with you, not wanting anyone to perish, but everyone to come to repentance. As in his parable, the bridegroom, the Lord Jesus, he's delaying because he doesn't want anyone to be left outside, knocking on that door, begging, "Sir, sir, please let us in." Jesus describes that day this way. He says, "It will come like a thief in the night." And when it comes, John says, "Let us rejoice and be glad and give him glory, because the wedding of the Lamb has come and his bride has made herself ready." The true bride of Christ has been prepared. Unlike an earthquake, which you can't really prepare for, because of his love, Jesus has given us this parable in the gospel, and he's given it to us to prepare us, to make us anticipate with joy being part of the greatest event in human history, all that will unfold afterwards in eternity. The time to prepare, friends, it's now, by being watchful, waiting in hope for the end of the age to come. When the time comes, when that time comes, the Father will say to his Son, "Son, everything is ready." He wants us to be prepared when he comes at the end of the age. He wants to welcome us personally to the great marriage banquet of the Lamb. He wants us to be ready. Thanks be to God. Amen.
When the music fades and all is slipped away, and I simply come, longing just to bring something that's of worth that will bless your heart, I'll bring you more than a song, for a song in itself is not what you have required. You search much deeper within, through the way things appear, you're looking into my heart. I'm coming back to the heart of worship, 'cause it's all about you, all about you, Jesus. I'm sorry, Lord, for the thing I've made, when it's all about you, all about you, Jesus. about you, all about you.
Jay Holmes, it is my pleasure to be leading us in prayer this morning. Please join me in the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever and ever. Amen.
Thank you for joining with us this morning. I hope that you have found these words of Jesus encouraging to you in these tumultuous times that we are living through. I hope his words give you encouragement and hope that something new is being birthed in the work of God through the time that we are living in, and that you and I can look forward with encouragement to that great day. So as we close our service this morning, hear this benediction. Friends, may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and fill you with his great peace. Amen. God bless. Have a great week.